What's up, Wholesale Nation? Andy Speed here.
And Andre King.
So we've got a special guest for you today. She's out of Houston. She's working in Dallas. She's working in San Antonio.
And she's growing working that, everywhere.
And growing that from more markets soon. We've got Elizabeth Navarrete.
Perfect.
Thank you. Did I get
yes,
it?
You did.
Oh,
hit
I
it?
Tried
did
to roll
nailed
roll.
It. You absolutely nailed it. Yes, you did.
So thank you for coming on. I know you're busy. I know you have a lot going on right now. So I appreciate you taking the time.
Absolutely. Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. I'm so right. excited. And what better way to connect with some amazing colleagues here in the industry. So I appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And so, yeah, I think I met you, maybe it's been about a year ago, right? So I know that you came out to our meetup once. I think it was right when we first started, right?
The very first meetup is where I was at.
Yeah, yep. Yeah, I remember that. And because you said, hey, I'm glad you put one on this side of town, that kind of thing, right?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, and so that was kind of our reason because we wanted to be close. We wanted to be close to the office, actually just right down the street, right?
Right.
And so now, you know, you've come, things have changed a lot since then, right? Been busy, you've been stretching yourself since then. Right?
I have. Yes, I have. Okay. Absolutely. Yes. Yeah. I really decided that about a year ago that I wanted to take my business to another level.
Right.
I really wasn't sure what level I wanted to be at. And it's more than what I actually anticipated.
Right.
So very exciting things are happening. So,
okay,
yes.
Perfect. So let's tell everyone who is Elizabeth and how you got started in this business and to where you're at now.
Absolutely. Well, Elizabeth, I am ever evolving. I am continuously growing and I'm continuously learning from my mistakes and learning some very, I guess you could say, expensive lessons.
Right.
And like we all do, right? The moment you lose money, you're like, okay, what am I doing wrong? This is not something external of me. It's something that's happening internally and we
right.
need to fix that. So how I got in this business, I started as a social worker. That was mainly what I went to school for.
Okay.
So
that's
I transferred. It's very different.
So you've always been about the money.
Totally. That's all. My only drive and my only desire is money. Yes, that's it. So the skill set that I had that I applied in my social work profession is very, you know, you have to be empathetic, you need to be a good listener, you need to be able to connect with people and be a people person. And mm-hmm. so when I was given the idea to switch over to real estate, I'm like, I've never sold anything in my life.
Right.
And I quickly realized you really don't need to sell anything. If you're a good person and people like you, you're personable, that will take you a long way. And
right.
so I did the transition from social worker to realtor. That's how I entered the industry as
right.
a realtor. So I did everything backwards.
Yeah.
Started as a realtor. Then I came in the game when 2003 at its peak, the market
right.
was really, really well, doing really well. And lots of money was being made, you know, as far as the retail space.
Right.
And so that's how I started. And I did very well. However, we also, as my partner and I, we also decided that we wanted to flip. But it was when, you know, Flip This House was on. You know, I don't want
right.
to pitch those shows, but
right.
those,
hey,
you
that's
know,
how I got started okay. watching those shows. So.
Right. And it's like, if they can do it, I can do it. But,
right.
you know, you don't realize that those shows only run 30 minutes or an hour and flips take 3 months or 4 months. And depending on the contractors that you have,
right.
Obviously they never show the bad contractors no. on TV. So when you have bad contractors.
What they do, but it's like during a commercial, like right before a commercial, they have something bad happen and then they fix it right after and they make $100,000.
I remember my first flip. I was like, man,
exactly.
when's the commercial break? I need this thing to turn around.
Exactly, right? And things happen very quickly and in a positive way, but in real life, it does not.
Right.
And now, fast forward so many years later, 2019, I realize, okay, well, you know, when what I see on TV or what I see on a podcast, that's great from mm-hmm. whoever I'm following, but that takes time to mm-hmm. get to that place. And there were a lot of hiccups along the way.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so that was 2003 and you got into becoming a realtor. Now, like we were saying, a lot of people that get into this business, they feel like, they think they have to be in sales, right? They have to. And as we found out, it's nothing about sales, right? It's all about people and
Absolutely.
Figuring out how you can help somebody and figuring out their problem, right?
Yep.
So you don't have to come from a sales background in order to do this. You can come from wherever you want to be. You just got to have the desire to want to help people. And mm-hmm. that's how you become successful with this business. Right?
Absolutely. Yeah. I have met some amazing colleagues that come from corporate America mm-hmm. and management. And that's key because,
right.
okay, you weren't selling anything in management, but you were managing a team. You were managing something big. So that translates very well into real estate investing.
Right.
And because we're running a business. It's not about just flipping a house or wholesaling. It's running an operation. And that's something that we all should really take the time to do. And we can talk a little bit more about that along the way. But yes, so I did really well 2003. Then we went into what was 2007,
right,
which is what we felt to be the recession. Everybody else calls it the 2008 recession. It really happened to us in 2007, close to the end of the year. And I remember this clearly because it was before Christmas time.
Right.
And we were like, what are we going to do? We had our office in Chicago. We had an office here in Houston. You had 100% refi in in Illinois.
Wow.
Here you had the 80% rule. So,
and how was the market in Chicago compared in Illinois compared to Texas?
It was outrageous.
Okay.
It was outrageous, outrageous. It was like refi after refi on a yearly basis.
Wow.
Values were increasing tremendously fast and high. So we got a bungalow, $300,000, like maybe 2003. And by the time we hit 2007, that was worth $500,000. And it's 1920s bungalow, not a big deal, right?
Right.
I mean, it's close to the city, but it wasn't anything wow. Just the values were going up super high. And that's an indicator, right? When things are going too fast, too high, too fast, that's exactly.
Yeah.
It's gotta
eventually
drop. And yes, and so the rug was pulled underneath our feet and we were not prepared.
You were in the mortgage business at that time, right?
I was a retail real estate agent and my partner was a mortgage broker.
Okay.
Then.
So
he would always transfer me, here's a lead, here's a lead, here's a listing, here's a buyer. And I was just going crazy doing all that, which was great. And then again, because money was coming so fast, we were spending it just as quickly and our lifestyle was just ridiculous.
Yeah. Do you remember there was a show called Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous? I think I saw her on there.
That is crazy. No,
I'm just kidding. But
it was something like that.
But you probably felt like that. If you took a house from 2003 and it grew in value like that, I mean, you probably, just like you said earlier, that you felt invisible. Like, man, I can do anything at this point, right? I can just buy anything and it becomes gold.
I'm not old enough for that show. For me, it was Cribs.
Stop. We watched that too.
So fast forward, you got into real estate on the wholesale side, the flipping side. Mm-hmm. How was that transition for you?
It's transitioned well and slow. Okay. Mm-hmm. We didn't transition fast. And what I mean transition is, well, so we started flipping. That was our main business model. And then we were like, okay, well, we're getting good deals, but let's try this wholesale side of it where we can get our own deals. And that's worked well. However, in that business model, you always have to be very open for change because there are changes in the business that will indicate that your marketing will have to shift according to how the market is going. If you're having a micro change in the market or a macro change, like with Harvey here in Texas, we had a macro change.
Yeah.
And so we had to switch it up. So with that being said, you always have to be cognizant that you want to work in your business and sometimes be out of it, but you always have to be cognizant of those changes and you have to pivot to where it will make sense and work.
So how do you manage that in your business?
So we're pretty much going, we started studying what's happening in other cities and other states. And we study, you have to also be aware of what's going on in the on Wall Street as well, because that's an indicator too. If things are really high and then you're going to see how things are going to drop quickly. And that's kind of like a preface to what's to come.
Right.
So you have to study that. And also to us, what helps us is talking to other people in the industry, because and I'll talk in general terms, as an entrepreneur, we live lives as solopreneurs.
Right.
I don't know if you guys relate to this, but a lot of people I've spoken to, it's like, look, it's amazing to be an entrepreneur. You're on your own, but you literally are on your own.
Right.
So if you're having financial issues with your business, or if you're having management issues, there's nobody going to be around to help you.
Right.
You really aren't going to have somebody to say, don't worry about it, it's taken care of and your check is here.
No,
that doesn't work
that
way.
It
doesn't work that way at all. And so for me, it's like, I've had to find mentors in the industry, and I keep switching up mentors, because for when you start, you have a certain type of mentor, right? To guide you with your mindset and all these things. But then as you get further along the way, you acquire different mentors, and we just kind of shake it up that way. For example, we recently went to one of Steve Trang's Blueprint Mastermind, which really helped, because he showed us what his operation is and how many people are in it and what's his overhead and all these things. And we're like, oh, we can switch it up. Right. So just those tweaks that you need to do along the way really, really help fix what's going on in your business.
Yeah, and that absolutely, looking at all those, the different business models and the different coaches, mentors, et cetera, helps you realize who you want to be, exactly. You know, and how you want to build the business around you, the individual, right. And not necessarily, you know, you can copy and paste in a lot of situations, but you really start looking at yourself. And as you grow as an entrepreneur, you really start to understand yourself a lot more. And that's phenomenal to get the inspiration from other people and, you know, just the validation that it's possible to make that shift and whatnot. I think that's great. Mm-hmm. Great to do, and you know, I'm sure that's contributed to your growth quite a bit.
It has, and also even just recently we went with Sharper Business Solutions in Chicago with Gary Harper and Susan Harper, and they're phenomenal. They're really big on running that PI test and seeing what all the people in your team, what are they, what seat are they in, and what is the forte, because we may have an integrator trying to do other things that they shouldn't be, or craftsmen getting out there and doing acquisitions when that's not really their passion.
Right.
You need to put people in the right seats. And even you as the CEO of your company, you need to know if you should even be the sit-in CEO or CEO of your own company. So I like Gary's style, and that's something different that we've brought into our business too, to teach ourselves what are really our strengths. We already know our strengths, but if we can see it drawn out if you do your mapping, your process mapping, and you see what role you're supposed to sit in, then it all makes sense.
Right. Mm-hmm. So for those that don't know, she referenced PI, that's predictive index. That's is it a personality test? Is it just kind of to help you dig in?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. It helps you dig in and tells you what your strengths are and what how to work well with that personality. So if you're an integrator, every business must have an integrator, right? I'm a promoter for my company, oddly enough. And so I'm like, okay, well, I think I'm going to stay in that promoter side. Right. You know, we have a maverick on our company, which is kind of a loose cannon. When we all have that loose cannon in our companies, don't we?
Uh-oh.
So, yes. Are you maverick?
I might be. I don't know.
So those mavericks are loose on rules. So if that's you, you may be captain, or you may be, I don't know, what have you taken the PI test?
Wrangler, maybe.
What are you?
Yeah, I'm a little bit of Wrangler, I guess, is a good
Wrangler
word.
Hey, everybody grew back in.
Everybody come back over here. Okay. Let's go this way.
That's
now.
That's good. That's good that you have that. That's great. Right. So yeah, you get everyone back on track, right. And let's
Every
do
once
this.
In a while, you have to take Andy. Like, oh, come back over here.
Gotcha. But we haven't, to answer your question. No, we haven't done.
Okay.
No, we haven't.
I highly recommend. It's interesting to see. Once you see who in your company is what, you'll be able to understand them better.
And what's the name of it?
Predictive index.
Just a predictive index. Okay,
I can send you a link for that. The overview, there's a PDF that gives you I call it the cheat sheet, where you can look it up and see. Like, I have a craftsman now that we just recently hired, and I'm like, oh yes, I get it, because he asked me so many years, so now what do I do next? And because he's a craftsman, he's good at crafting things. You give him an idea and he'll craft them, but he needs more guidance,
right?
And so it's interesting, and it'll teach you how to work better with those individuals.
Yeah. And I think because we had looked at that at one point for hiring people, right? So making sure we get the right person versus just doing like the DISC test and things like that, right?
If you integrate both of them, it will really, really help you put the right people in the right seats.
Right.
Because you may have somebody that's doing acquisitions and they're really better. They're going to thrive in dispositions. Mm-hmm. And you just do the switch and you'll see night and day. Even if they don't want to do it, just give them that nudge, push them out there, and they'll thrive and they'll love it. They just don't know. They don't know it yet.
Yeah. Some people just don't want to give up, right? They think, I can do it. But then you realize that that's not your wheelhouse. Right. And you put them in it then you do them a, you know, a service of letting them to thrive. Because now you got, because you probably have the right person. They're just not in the right seat.
Exactly.
Is what this is helping you do.
That's exactly right. And one of my mentors as well talks about heart and gut, right? Mm-hmm. That you have to have that in your company. Mm-hmm. You have to have that heart. I think I bring that twist or that seasoning into my company. And then you have that gut, which is the analyzer, the person that's going like, okay, tweaking things. But I'm more like, I like to envision things and I like to put heart into it, because that's just gives you a different outlook on things.
Right. Mm-hmm. And so far as your business today, you know, for hiring and things like that, what does your business look like now? And what you do.
Okay, so we've transitioned from growing our, so we were established with 15, 20 people locally in our office and everything. But as we were losing individuals little by little, because they were, you know, very enthused to see, or very, maybe not motivated enough to see how much they were making versus how much the deal was. They don't realize there's a lot of what we discussed earlier. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of stuff going on the back end as far as acquiring a lead and cleaning up your list and skip tracing, inputting them into the caller, the dialers and all those things. So they were like, well, I can go run and do this on my own.
Right.
And they don't realize all that back end work that requires to get to just log in and dial away. Mm-hmm. So
now were these wholesalers or acquisitions people? So how did they get into your business? And
so
and
that's
that?
A great question. Right. So, okay. So because I've been doing a lot of podcasts and a lot of interviews, I have people that reach out to me afterwards and they're like, oh, I'd love, because I'm here. I'll help you. I'm like the Mother Teresa of wholesaling. I'll help you. And if you're struggling, I'll help you. And then I realize, wait, no, I'm not going to help you.
Yeah,
because
that's
I'm a
what
promoter.
It is. Exactly how
that's
you
what it is.
Yes, exactly.
I get
so,
it.
So people would come up to me or write to me. I heard you on this show, and I'd like to be a part of your team. And I was getting overwhelmed with all the people that reached out to me, where it was like, well, okay, great. Yes, come on board. I'll help you. And I realized I can help them, but they have to help themselves. So you have to show up for yourself. And that's been kind of my message lately with people that I'm on board. Look, I had to get help from some of my mentors and say, look, what am I going to do? Because I don't like to turn people away. I don't like to tell them no.
Right.
And they're like, look, send them a questionnaire. Get them to work from even before offering you a cup of coffee or offering you a lunch. And either they will, number one, go away, or number two, they will answer halfway, and that completely will tell you that they're not in it, or they will completely fill it out. And those are the people you want to take the time to take it a next step further.
Okay.
So we run them through the PI testing. So I'm not taking on, you know, new people at this time.
Right.
Okay. And this is a reason why. Because of me trying to bring on all these people, helping people and saying, yeah, everyone come on board and help me. Well, I was spending a lot of time training, and then they would just go off and do it on their own.
Right. They became competition. At least they thought they were competition.
Right. Exactly. Right. And I'm all for sharing the wealth. I'm all for building leaders and building entrepreneurs. I'm all for that. I am 500% behind that. However, I think that it's important to maintain a team. And so we started transitioning into VAs.
Mm-hmm.
So we started with a small VA. So we had a small VA team from the Philippines and a large team here locally. Mm-hmm. Well, then we started transitioning and even seeing that our cold calling and our VAs weren't really working out, because we were missing one important ingredient, which we bring to the table, and we were missing out on the bilingual aspect of it. Mm-hmm. As far as the English and Spanish.
Okay.
We would get a lot of sellers are like, I don't speak English. I need someone in Spanish.
Right.
So we were missing that mark. Mm-hmm. And so we transitioned and we looked into Latin America. So mm-hmm. we started a small team in Ecuador, and now we have a full-blown team in Venezuela and in Nicaragua.
Okay.
Yeah, so that and our cold callers are amazing, because at some point these individuals have lived in the U.S. or in Canada. So their English is, it's just beautiful. It's very nice and clear. And their Spanish is obviously impeccable. So it's worked out really well for us. We're like, oh, okay, we'll start with 3-4. And now we're up to 10 plus people on our teams.
So let's talk about that, because I know a lot of people, they hear about telecommunication. They talk about cold calling, right? And then the first thing they heard was you went and hired some people, and now you got some people calling. So there's going to be some people that say, you know what? I'm getting ready to go to Latin America, and I'm getting ready to open me a call center. Is that going to work for them? and they've never done anything before.
It takes a while. No, but you have to really curate your team, number one, and spend a lot of time training.
Right.
But they are totally worth that investment that you're making in them. Right. Because you make that investment, and the way, I'll just give you a couple of ways we do it. We have one team lead per call center. Mm-hmm. And so we tell them, look, we want you to thrive and have your own business.
Right.
Because these are people that have worked in call centers before, maybe managed a team before, but they worked for somebody. They never got anything from that. So we're saying, look, you build a team, you can onboard them, interview, take that. You have to delegate.
Right.
And that's something that's sometimes problematic for mm-hmm. certain people, right? To delegate and say, well, I don't know if they're going to do it the right way. You just have to train them right. And if you do train them right, you can forget about
Let them fly.
Let them fly. Right. Let them do it. And if you say, you know, well, you can build your team and I'll support whatever you need from me. Mm-hmm. And then this is how the pay structure is going to be. You get a percentage, they get paid this way and things like that. And you let them build on just that foundation that you set. You will have them for life and they will grow a tremendous team for you.
Right.
We just got a guy from Apple that was doing Apple social media for Apple in South America. And it's like now he's working for us. And I'm like, yes, I needed somebody for social media because I was going crazy doing it myself. Right. And it's just, it drives me crazy. But so you just have to be able to delegate, but delegate correctly.
Right.
And intelligently. It's not just about, okay, you're hired, you're in.
Right.
You got to really train them.
Right. And that's the biggest thing, right? You have to train them. You just can't put them out there and expect them to do the work. You can't fire them because you didn't train them properly and that kind of thing, right?
Right.
If they know
you
how
can,
to,
but
yeah,
you're but, really doing a disservice to them and yourself.
Yeah, yeah, you'd be spinning your wheels. At the end of the day, they have families and things, and they want to do well for you. But if you don't give them anything of what your company is about and how you want it to get it done, then it's not going to get done, right?
Right.
So that's huge. So. Mm-hmm. You have someone who's managing, that person's taking care of everything of hiring. They're doing QCing and things like that with your cold callers, right?
Correct.
So now they bring in the lead. What happens from there?
Then we have a lead intake person that mm-hmm. takes care of also from as a VA that's, you know, overseas. So they do the lead intake. They make sure that the lead is solid, that what would be the exit strategy for that. And of mm-hmm. course, I don't know if you've heard this or I'm sure you apply this in your business, but we want to make sure we have at least 3 exit strategies for that lead.
Okay.
And then from there, we have an acquisitions agent go out mm-hmm. and talk to them face to face.
Okay.
We haven't fully transitioned into virtual wholesaling yet. We're working on it now.
Right.
Where it's a struggle. It's not easy because it was hard for us to even let go of going to the appointments ourselves.
Right.
And letting the acquisition. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
Do you with me on that?
Totally agreement with that. It's almost like we talked about with. If you brought up salespeople for 3 or 4 years and they've been going out on appointments, right? And that's the way that you were trained how to do this business, right? It's hard to transition as a business owner. And then you got to also transition your people.
Right.
Versus you see people, like we know several people who they've never went out on an appointment. They've always bought over the phone and they don't know anything any different, right? And they're still successful. So I think a lot of it is it's in our mind, but it's the way that we were trained to sell and to acquire properties.
Absolutely.
And for us, we'll see a little drop because of that. But I think you'll rebound because you'll figure it out.
Absolutely. Okay? Absolutely. And I think with this, is going back to answering that question fully about who am I? I'm reinventing myself continuously.
Yeah.
And I learned early on to me is 2007 because I was just a realtor then.
Right.
I really didn't consider myself an investor. And I was just focusing on one method. And then investing was kind of something for fun, just to kind of as a hobby style, and then having to transition from, okay, the retail space is not really going to work for me for quite some time because lenders were not giving money. So
right.
I didn't have any buyers, and that whole market was dry. So it took us some time to transition fully into investing.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yep. So today you have the 10 plus cold callers in across 3 cities. So you have acquisitions agents in each of the 3 cities then.
Correct.
Out on appointments.
Okay. I do. Mm-hmm. I do.
So how do you determine? Do you have one in each market?
I do. I have one in each market right now. Again, we're trying to transition everything to make it virtual.
Okay.
So mm-hmm. where it's not like we're going to appointments anymore. And that's been a struggle. I'm not going to lie. It was a struggle for us to, even when we hired our acquisitions agents, to finally let them go on their own. And we were no longer going on appointments. I haven't gone to an appointment in a while. I think the last time I went was probably a month ago. And it took me 3 hours at that appointment. because again, I'm the heart person. So I go in and I like to connect with people, and I was having tea with the homeowner and talking, playing with their puppy and all this stuff. And it's like, I was told, you're fired from that. Like, you're not to go to any acquisitions appointment because you're just too long. You take too long. We got the deal.
There you go.
I got the deal.
That's what I was telling Andy. Because he was like, they were like, who's the best salesperson in the house? Of course, I say I am, right? It's just that's what I said. And then he said, you hadn't been to an appointment in like 3 years.
I was like, right.
How would you know?
Yeah, I may be a little rusty, but.
Hey, I mean, you may get rusty, but you still have it. It's that, it, you know, what's the secret sauce? We all have our own secret sauce. And that's, I don't mean like a secret, because it's not rocket science, right? It's just your special seasoning, the way you handle things, the way you carry yourself, the way you communicate. I think that is key. Just be yourself. And if you're really not a people person, then you really need to be in the back analyzing data. And that's great, because your job is very important.
Right.
So that's been a challenge for me in training salespeople, is because I've never been in sales. Okay. Right. And then I'm expected to, you know, start training salespeople. It's like, well, I don't know how to train salespeople. Let's lean on, you know, John Martinez. Let's lean on some of the other stuff.
Sure. And,
you know, you ask me how I do it. I'm got a pretty good closing rate. I mean, I've got the record for our company over a sustained period of time, over 3 years, right? So, but I don't know how to train salespeople. So how do you go about training them?
So I'm very lucky, because when I call my partner, he's my life partner and my business partner. So we're always on the business, right? And so I'm very lucky, because he had his own, marketing company within his mortgage company. So we had just people cold calling right there on the spot in his office, and he trained them all. And so he loves that aspect of it. Okay. Me, not so much. I'm not going to lie and tell you that that's me, because no, I'm more like, I'll go to the appointment. I'll meet with the people. Take me to the masses. That's where I belong, right? I love that. But his thing is he's very technical with how do you speak to people on the phone. Mm-hmm. And he's continuously monitoring our cold callers. Even I know he's doing that now. I know he's listening into their conversations and kind of like whispering, hey, do this, change this. So he's constantly working on that. And that's something that I need to get him out of. But he loves doing that. So it's fine, as long as we're getting deals done and closing, right?
And if he's happy.
Right. And so that's where you have that synergy, as far as when you create a partnership. Not all partnerships work, right? But it's a marriage. It's another marriage. And you have to continuously work on it. And and since you guys are partners, and I don't mean this in a wacky way, but you have to continuously date each other, meaning that when you first joined forces, you were in that honeymoon phase where you were perfect in his eyes, he was perfect in your eyes.
Right.
And so what happens when you're really in the trenches and things go kaput? Right. Mm-hmm. How do you see each other then?
Say, this guy, here he comes.
Here's the Maverick.
Because I've got so many jokes
right now. We're going to keep this clean. So your thought is, here's the Maverick, you know. Not that I'm labeling you, but you let me know what your PI is. But let's just say Maverick, and you're like, oh, Maverick, you know, Mavericks are loose cannons. You have to reel them in. They're loose on the rules.
Right.
And however, and possibly if you're a captain, well, you want to see things happening. You want to see systems. You want numbers. Mm-hmm. You want all the analytics of it. And that might not be your forte. So you see what I mean? It's like when you, when you have that partnership, you also have to see that vision with your team too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you bring them on, oh, they're great, they're clean. And then when they're not doing so well, okay, what's going on?
Right.
What's the problem? Right. Is it them? Is it us? Is it our data? Is it what? You have to go back and back to the drawing board. This is why I go back and say, I continuously am in that phase of reinventing myself, because even if you're set and your company's doing very well and your business operation is great, you always have to tweak it.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah,
because it's always changing.
Yeah.
It's ever so changing. We're in that marking of it's just evolving continuously with the technology that's going on. It's just, from mailers to having to do RVMs and texts and cold calling, and it's like, oh, possibly now mailers again. So it's those things that you have to continuously go with the move, I guess.
And you have to continue to learn. Like I think I was talking to one of our sales guys, one of our core values, and it's because we couldn't figure out anything else to go with a Y, because we were trying to spell out Draco, was yearn to learn, right? And I was thinking about it, and I was like, but the day you stop learning is the day you also stop earning. right?
Correct.
And it's the same thing. Like in this business, you have to continue to look and learn, and you know, maybe you have to learn a different marketing channel, a new way of selling properties. Maybe you have to start going virtual. But if you stop doing that, then you're going to get left behind. That's right. And that's why you have to continue to work on yourself. And that's why you've probably continued to reinvent yourself. You're continuing to learning, like what's, you know, what worked 3 or 4 years ago may not work today.
Correct.
Okay.
That's absolutely right.
So things have changed. So far as your marketing, so I know that you're doing your cold calling. What else are you guys doing?
We're doing text, relying a lot on text. And here's a secret, I guess, pro tip right there. Mm-hmm. If you use a female name with your text, you'll get a better response.
All right. Switching Michael to Michelle.
Yes. And
welcome back, Michelle.
Yes, yes.
We use Michael, but we're going to Michelle now.
I'm telling you, you do that switch to female, you'll get a better response. People right. are just, they're not rude and mean. I'm sure you guys have the craziest emails and we get the craziest responses too. But the moment you switch to a female, they're just nicer.
There
it's
you
interesting.
Go.
Interesting. Yep.
All right. Golden nugget.
Yep. That's it helped us. I mean, it's something so simple, those little tweaks, but I picked that up from somebody else. I think somebody in Phoenix said it. And I was like, we were like, what? Really? Okay, let's do that. And we immediately had our cold call, our VA, hey, switch it up. Do a female name. Mm-hmm. Now we use Brittany and it's worked well. So for
I like
us.
That.
Yeah.
That's a great tip.
Yeah. We had, I think this is the first time we actually went to a male, right? In the last 3 months or so, we've always had a female name.
Okay.
I need to take a look at that.
Have you seen a drop in your numbers?
I don't know. But I need to take a look at that.
Okay. Because
that's, we'll try both and see how it goes. Right.
But at the same time, we had an uptick in telecommunication. So it's hard to.
Yeah, we changed some of the marketing. So we don't know.
Regardless.
Yeah. That was just mailers. Like we did mailers and we don't do a lot of mailers anymore. So.
Right. Yep. Okay. That's with us too.
Yeah. And so telecommunication, and you mentioned that mailers are like not your thing right now. But
right. And just today I was listening to Daniel Chadmore in Dallas and he was talking about the cyclical market and, you know, what to do when things change. And he's like, we're looking where mailers are going to do a comeback. And it's like, oh, geez, really?
Yep.
You know, I was again, reinvent. You know, you can't, the moment you get comfortable, that's when your business is really not going to it's not going to go full throttle and you are going to experience a hiccup somewhere.
Right.
You have to continuously be uncomfortable.
So just so we're clear to the new wholesaler that's out there, that doesn't mean she's not talking about diversifying. We're not talking about a $500 marketing budget. We've got, you know, you're sending out a lot of marketing. So it's a massive shift. It's steering a ship. It's not, you know, I'm going to spend $500 and I'm going to split that up between mail. I'm going to split it up between cold calling and text.
Right.
You know, you need to focus on one.
Right.
You know, if your budget is limited as you're getting into the higher levels of marketing, then, you know, start looking at diversifying that a little bit.
So to give you an idea, we're doing 10 to 15,000 daily is what we're doing. Text, you can't because your campaign won't let you. You can only do a certain amount. I believe that's 500 or 350. I can't remember. But so with cold calling, that's how we're doing ours. And that's a lot.
Right. Yeah, and so with cold calling, are you guys using Mojo or any other type?
We're using Call Tools.
Okay, that's what we use also. Yeah,
Call Tools. And then for text, we're using Roar and we're also using Text Magic.
Okay.
Interchangeably.
Mm-hmm. All right, good. Yep. Yeah, and for those who are looking to do it, Call Tools has a really neat feature. So it allows you to listen in live to your agents, right?
Yep.
So
you can give them some media feedback. You can whisper in their ear.
Exactly. Right.
It's some pretty cool features.
Which I'm telling you, my partner's doing that now. I know him. He loves to listen. I'm like, what are you listening to? He's like, what? He's like, and it's like, and he starts talking to them. And I'm like, okay, that's really cool. Again, I don't run that side of the operation, but I know what's happening.
Right.
I have to know what's going on in my company. I can't just not do it, right? But he loves that. And so he loves to go in and tweak and change. And yeah, we do switch up our script too.
Right.
So there's not one particular script. Like John Martinez is very, very good. We've gone to several other trainings where we were like, oh, we like this piece. And we'll sit down, analyze all the top, like our top three, four, and then we'll take the pieces that we like and then we create our own.
Right.
And then even then you have to also switch that up too.
Right. Okay. And so we're going to transition, right?
Okay.
Because you have a shirt that says, it almost looks like Wholesale Nation, but it says Wholescaling.
Wholescaling
Live. So
yes,
Wholescaling Live came about maybe a month or so ago, right?
It actually came about 60-ish days ago. Okay. Not too long.
So, yes. So tell us about it.
All right. So yes, Wholescaling Live. You know, all these people that I've been meeting in the last year and a half by going outside of my market has really, number one, just really helped explode my business because of the fact that all the tips that I'm getting, all the golden nuggets I'm getting from everyone is just quite impressive. And so I've been able to learn and scale that way. But not only that, we decided that why not bring all these people that we know have been very successful, they're doing phenomenal in their business. They've also gone through the lows to get to the highs, right? And all of these people, if you study them, each and every one of them, whether they have their own podcast or they do an interview or they're doing some live video, they talk about their struggles and what hasn't worked and what they're doing now to make it work. So we decided to bring the top people, at least the people that we thought were top notch,
right?
And nationwide, we really don't have any Houston speakers on mm-hmm. stage. They're all from
my heart
other
hurts
cities.
A little bit.
Yeah,
I'm sorry about that, but next time we'll if we decide to do something else later.
You heard it already. She said next time. Oh, so man. There's going to be a next one coming up.
We need to edit this.
We'll keep that in there.
Post-production, please eliminate that. If we do have another one, we'll keep you guys in mind. But so we decided to bring top-notch people in the industry that are doing very well, but that have that go-giver mentality and won't only show you the shines and the and the wins, but will also dig in, pull back the curtain, and talk about the losses. Because we rarely hear about the losses. We hear about all these success stories and how they do all these deals a month and how they make all this revenue a month. However, we don't hear all the back end stuff that's happening. And so I've just been to me, it's just amazing to bring, finally get them all together in one room, in one space, and here in Houston, because I'm kind of tired of traveling everywhere. I love it, but don't you guys? I mean, it's always traveling, having to go to Arizona, Phoenix, or to Tampa, or to Chicago, or different cities to learn. Well, we're gonna bring them all here to our own background.
Right.
Yep.
Okay. And so everyone that's in there has a wholesale business that they've scaled and now, like she said, they've gone through some struggles, things like that.
Right.
And now they're of course growing their business. Right. So putting this together, right. So we're talking about Elizabeth now. So we got the Wholescaling Live is going to be coming up October 4th and 5th. Right.
October 4, 5, and 6.
4, 5, and 6.
Yes.
And then it's going to be where?
It's going to be here in Houston, Texas, particularly the Woodlands. We like to say Houston because then people are like, where's the Woodlands at? So it's Houston, Texas, north part of Houston. And the whole idea behind this is what we're going to do is address every issue a real estate investor is having in their business, from putting people in the right seats, onboarding. We're having Nick Perry from Austin. I don't know if you guys know him. He works for Indeed.com.
Right. He's been on the show.
He has been on the show. You're right. And so he's phenomenal. He's going to talk to us about how to onboard the right people, what the process looks like, and how to have your business run on autopilot pretty much. And from there to the data, like even getting the data, that is so key for your business. If you don't have the right data, you're missing out. If you start analyzing, you need to go where all your colleagues are missing out on, right? That's where you win. That's where the wins are. So we have Annie Draganova with Batch Skip Tracing. She's going to be talking about data and just the analytics about it and just going full deep into that, which is key, because if you don't have the right data, then you're really missing the mark.
Right.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And so Daniel Chad Moore from Propelio, he's coming too from Dallas. He's just a genius. I don't know if you follow him and you listen to him, but he's going to talk about cyclical markets and how to save us from really losing out. And so when the peak is really at its low, that's where we step in, how we can optimize on that and help and build our businesses and explode it in that downturn. Right.
Right.
Jamie Burleson Woolley. She's also a phenomenal lady. RJ Bates, Rafael Vargas, Lee Kearney.
I say that different every time.
Vargas. Yeah. Yes, Mr. Vargas. He's just young kid and he's doing fantastic. He's just, oh my gosh, $80 million is his projected revenue.
Wow.
Yes, it's tremendous. He's doing so well. And his whole entire operation is virtual wholesaling. Just that's it. It's virtual. So, which is great, which is amazing. And then, oh gosh, we have so many. I know I'm missing out. Jamil Damji, Mr. Astro Flipper himself with Keegley and out of Phoenix, Arizona. Everyone's coming from Phoenix.
Right.
Phoenix,
yeah, I think all of Phoenix and people Jamil, are calling us.
Pace, Steve.
Yeah. Steve Trang with Real Estate Disruptors.
Annie, Lee Kearney.
Yes, Lee's. All of them. Yes, we have Don Costa. He's coming actually from California. Mm-hmm. And we have a rising star. I don't know if you've heard of him, Antoine Campbell. Mm-hmm. If you haven't, that gentleman, he is so intelligent. Yeah. And he has really built his business and done a lot with it in 2 years. Right. Something that people in 5 years experience haven't been able to accomplish. Yeah. He's very intelligent and he's really, really figured things out. Right. So he's somebody to follow.
Great guy if you're wanting to learn how to run a business through virtual assistants. Yeah.
Yes. Tremendous. Oh gosh. Well, I don't know. I'm sure I'm missing.
Most excited about?
Me? Oh gosh. I can't say. I can't say because they're all, it's like a mom bring
She's
asking
Mother
her
Teresa.
Kids,
how are you going to ask her that?
Asking which kid is your favorite. Like, they're all my favorite. I really, truly love all of them. There's a few that I don't know personally, but most of them, the reason why that we selected them is because they are either, you know, our mentors or also, and also our friends and colleagues in the business. And what I mean is when I said go givers is that they, share openly what their business looks like. And it's giving me ideas to come back home and say, okay, well, this is something I'm going to implement. And like Pace is phenomenal. He is one of those people that you get in his car and you definitely don't want to do anything other than listen to what he has to say.
Right.
Because every moment he's with you, he's just throwing stuff at you like, this is how it's working. And he was top 5 in the nation with another franchise, which we will not mention. Mm-hmm. And he did very well, sold for top dollar. And now he's on his own and he's doing great. And he's just giving it all. And that's hard to find. Right. We don't find a lot of people like that in our industry.
Right.
At least I know I haven't.
And so you have your own business going, right?
Yes.
You have a lot of pieces going on. You got cold callers to manage.
Right.
And you have this big event that you didn't say, hey, I'm going to do this a year or two from now.
No.
So how, number one, why? Right. And then how did you get the courage to be able to do and to do things like this?
That's a great question. I will give that credit to another set of mentors that I have. I'm part of the Zuckerberg Institute. Randi Zuckerberg is the founder, and she and with two of her colleagues, Michael Littig and Brian Patrick Murphy, the three of them have really helped shape and kind of put me in that mentality where think big.
Right.
And if you think big, think bigger.
Right.
And if you want to do that, do that. For example, I'll just give a quick example. Randi Zuckerberg, she was a techie in Silicon Valley. She had this dream and this desire of going to Broadway and producing a show. And people thought she was ridiculous for doing that. And she had people wrote up an article on the New York Times saying that this is just not going to happen. That's going to be an epic fail. And look at her now. She's a 2-time Tony Award winner.
Right.
And so listening to her story and watching just her be real, and she's also a go-giver, and she's all about shaping entrepreneurs.
Mm-hmm.
That really helped me take things into perspective, because I always had this mentality. You have these limiting beliefs, right? Am I good enough? Can I get this done?
Right.
Can I really be successful? And so you have to take those limiting beliefs and change them and put them into action and say, you know what? I am good enough. I'm better than I think I am. You know, not to sound so self-involved, but you really do have to feed yourself and feed yourself, feed your mind, and that mentality, that mindset is so key. Your mindset will either drive you up to success or will really sink you down.
Right.
And you're your only limitation.
Right.
So they motivated me, and they're like, look, Elizabeth, they didn't even know what I had planned. They're like, look, I have a couple of things, meaning we're launching our call center and I have something in mind, but it wasn't really formalized yet. They're like, you can do it. And you can do that and more, something bigger. And I'm like, okay, this is going to be big. This is huge. And when we decided to make it happen, it's like it had to happen this year. And for logistical purposes, it ended up being the beginning of October. It wasn't our ideal date and time. We wanted more time. We were thinking November, but it had to happen this year. Why this year? Because this year is a year of change and a year of growth. And if you're new in the business or if you're seasoned, this is the time to really buckle down and analyze what is happening in our industry and change things up. Because next year, our situation will be a lot different.
Right.
And we will either see, we will see a lot of people leave our industry. And that's the reality. That's where we're headed.
Right.
And so since we've been in this for, we want to stay in the long run. I've gone through the recession, big, full on recession in 2008. I can do this.
I got
this. I'm preparing now for next year.
Yeah.
So this is why we thought this is the year. And this is the year we need to address all of our issues and the problems we're having in our business and make it, tweak it, fix it. That way we're solid next year and we're ready to face this head on.
Right.
Love it.
Yeah. And when you know, everyone we've had on, you can kind of see the common denominator, right? Number one is the take action, right? The take action mentality. You know, everything that Elizabeth has said has been about taking action, right? The other thing is she surrounded herself around the right people, right? So whether it was in her backyard or getting out of side of her backyard, it's getting herself around the right people. Right. And then the other thing is she also got mentors at the same time. It wasn't just about networking. It was about getting the mentors to be able to help stretch her so she can do these type of things and expand her business, keep changing her business to so that it fits with the times and she can continue to grow. And then to put on an event, you know, like this. Right. This is your first time putting on this type of event?
It really is. Yeah. It's my very first time. I've been part of events, but I haven't really put anything on. And so there's a couple of us working together. It's a team of four. We call ourselves the Fantastic Four. Mm-hmm. I didn't name it like that, but, you know, it makes sense because we're all different. But we all bring our own seasoning into it. Mm-hmm. And it's working and we're really excited. This event is for everyone that is running a real estate investment business. It's not just geared only for wholesalers or for seasoned people. It can be for people that are also flipping, because that's something I didn't even touch on. I was doing a lot of flipping a year ago. If you would have told me you're going to transition fully to wholesaling, I would have been like, that's crazy. That's not going to happen.
Right.
Now I'm like, oh, okay, let's take this. And even I even said once on a podcast, I even talked down on virtual wholesaling and look at me. I'm doing that now. I'm working on getting there.
Take that one down.
So you can't always say this is not going to be part of my business model, because again, you have to be open to different avenues and switching things up. And so now we're trying not to close on buying our own deals. We're gonna offload them what we're looking at, and taking on less flips.
Okay. So Ed Milet said that becoming an entrepreneur is the greatest self-discovery process that you'll ever experience.
Oh my gosh,
that's absolutely true.
Right.
You never really know who you are until you become an entrepreneur.
Yeah. That's spot on. You don't know what you're made of until you become an entrepreneur. And even then you're like, oh man, you're going to really make it to your knees.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's going to take you to your knees.
That is true.
It's up to you to, like you said earlier, find the right people, put strategically place yourself with people, align yourself with people that you look up to and that you want to emulate. And that's what I've been doing this last year and a half. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's what then eventually they'll be your peers. And then, you know, you keep doing that.
Keep
and
you'll find keep a growing. New set.
Yeah, people will pull you up or pull you down.
Yes.
You know, who you surround yourself with matters.
Absolutely.
You know, I lost a lot of friends when I became an entrepreneur. I'm sure you have as well.
I sure have. And I continuously do. The more you grow and the more you level up, you're going to lose people along the way. And that's okay.
True. Yeah.
And that's okay.
You know, they can either come with you or not, but you can't really associate with that because you're, you know, getting into another group of five.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So,
how does our listeners, how do they reach out to you? I know right now you said that you're maybe not taking on anybody right now, but that could change by the next podcast.
Look, it could change. To me, here are my non-negotiables. You need to show me that you're actually in it to really show up for yourself, not show up for me, because you're not going to, it's not a me thing. It's for you. I can provide you all the tools that you need to succeed, but if you don't show up for yourself, that I can't do anything for you.
Right.
So to me, it's like, show me your deal machine. Show me you have at least, I know this is going to sound crazy, at least 200, 250 minimum leads in there. And we'll sit down and talk. And we'll sit down, don't invite me for coffee. Don't take me out for lunch.
Right.
Let's sit down in a controlled environment where we're going to talk business, very, very set time. And we'll see what we can do. But I really want to see what you're doing now to get ahead. And if you just say, look, I don't have anything, then I really, really, I'm not able to help you. You need to, there's so much information out. Look, it's not to sound mean or rude, because this is so outside of me to say no, because I always say yes, but I have to. And
it's fair though. You'll show up for them if they show up for themselves first.
Right.
Yes, that's key. That's exactly it. You said it better than I did. So yes. So he will be my spokesperson from now on. Thank you, Andy. Yes, exactly it. And I want everyone to succeed. And I think that there is so much information out there. Just listening to wholesale Wholesale Nation podcast. You'll get a lot of information. And then just from there, go off and look at other videos. And other, there's just a lot of, there's a wealth of information out there that wasn't out there when mm-hmm. we started.
Yep.
So you guys are very lucky to have that.
A lot of information out there now.
Enough to blow your brain out, because I can tell you that you know, I'm a junkie when it comes down to podcasting, and then quite naturally, then of course we do it also, right?
Right.
But I'm a junkie when it comes down to podcasts and free information and consuming YouTubes and things like that. I never mm-hmm. stop. I wake up early in the morning. I'm working out. I'm listening to, you know, I'm listening to people, and till the time I go home. Right.
Right.
And so that's why I try to listen to music here, because that's the only time I get to listen to music. And people are like, why are you listening to 90s? But that's my music. But
yeah,
you won't hear that from me.
Right. Yep. Well, guys, first of all, Elizabeth, we want to thank you for taking the time
thank you for having me.
I know you're busy. And of course, you got the Propelio show also. So busy with that
as
well.
Yes, yes. And I highly recommend, if you're new, you want to learn more about just even the jargon that we speak as far as investors, go on propelio.com /Academy. There's mm-hmm. a ton of information, from how to use your IRA to invest. I mean, from anything from A to Z, you will learn that on there.
Right.
It's great academy, and it's all free. Yeah. You don't have to pay for anything.
Yeah, they've invested quite a bit in that.
Yeah, and we're big believers in that, right? People who are able to give and they're not really looking to receive, right? And just and be able to give back. So, and that's what Wholesale Nation is about, right? The same thing. Right. So again, we want to thank you for coming out.
Thank you.
For our listeners, hope you enjoyed this. Hope you picked up some great nuggets from Elizabeth being out here. But if you have not had a chance to go on and give us a thumbs up, do that on the podcast. And if you're listening to this, don't forget to check us out on the YouTube. We'll have some other videos coming out on there as well.
Absolutely. And ask questions, right? We're here to answer. So if you have any questions about what we discussed today, post them in the comments.
There you go.
And I'll be on there looking and checking and answering questions. And you can also find me on Instagram at the REI CEO. Mm-hmm. That's the easy way. I had my name, but people were butchering my last name. So I'm like, I'm just going to change it. So it's easy, at the REI CEO. You can find me also Wholescaling Live. You can go to wholescalinglive.com and get information. You can also ask questions about the event here on the comments below.
Okay. And she's going to be our spokesperson now. She's really great.
Yeah, absolutely. I was like,
the promoter is on point right here. Well, guys, again, thanks for listening. We definitely appreciate it. Y'all come back now. You hear?